Okay, we're over here at Team Fury gym in Bolton. And I'm with my friend here, Peter Fury. Peter, great to see you.
Thank you, Chris. Always good to see you. Back. You're always welcome.
Appreciate it, mate. Just start with you. We've obviously had the news through that he's going to be fighting Parker. It's going to be in the UK. It was originally set for New Zealand. So good news that it's here. I know you can't really say too.
Frank, just keep noise down a bit because I've got this interview. Yeah, go on.
Yeah, I know you really can't say too much about it at the moment. You know, we know that the fight is on. What can you say about it at the moment? And you know, really, how pleased are you that it's going to be in the UK?
Yeah, we're ecstatic. He's worked all of his young life for this world title shot. We've got on well with Duco Events. Everything's been amicable. They've, believe it or not, this time round, not difficult to deal with. They know what they want, price-wise, it's been agreed. And we're 99.9% there, so it's we're expecting an official announcement very, very soon on it.
Just waiting to confirm.
Just waiting to put it all on paper and get it all confirmed, yeah.
How happy are you that it's going to be in the UK, and how happy is Hughie? You know, you don't have to travel up the other side of the world for it.
Well, ultimately it doesn't matter where you fight, but we're very happy it's here. It's a lot better. I think it's a lot better exposure for Hughie as well, rather than going all the way to New Zealand. There's a lot more fans here. This is, you know, Britain and the States. You know, they're massive in boxing, so why would a world title fight not be staged here? You know, New Zealand, beautiful country, I think there's 4 million people in it, against 66 million people in the UK, so it makes sense to bring the fight here, financially and for the fans as well, because a lot of people was missing out on not coming to the fight and seeing it. So it'll be a good fight because they're going to see something different in Hughie.
And Parker coming over here as well. You know, he's obviously a world champion. He's willing to come over here. Fair play to him. You know, in an ideal world, do you think he would have wanted it over here as well? You know, did it just come down to you know, maybe a financial thing, or just, you know, he's the champion. He's coming over here to.
Well, he knows. He knows as well. It wasn't hard work bringing him over here because him and his team said, you know, they really need to make a name for themselves as well. And what better way to do it against Hughie Fury and be in the UK and fight in his hometown, if you like, in his backyard, so which is the UK anyway, so that's where they're coming from. And they know to step into the big fights, they have to come here anyway. Yeah. So for them, it ticks the boxes as well. Yeah. Like I said, we're almost there, and we're hoping for an announcement imminent. Well, I'm hoping by the weekend.
The weekend, yeah.
We should be have a release on it.
The way British boxing is a real big revival at the moment as well, isn't it? You know, it's popular, so.
Well, exactly.
It's
yeah.
Place to fight.
It was amazing what Joshua done with Klitschko. You know, that whet the appetite, if nothing else. You know, people love that show. You know, 90,000 people, or so they say. It was massive. So it's a brilliant thing for the sport, isn't it?
Mm, absolutely. And you've put him in as a warm-up fight as well before this fight. He's probably, you know, it's got an old school thing to do. There's not many, we've got a heavyweight championship fight on the line. Would have a warm-up fight on a smaller card, on an undercard. But you know, it's definitely a good way of doing it, because he's not been in the ring now, has he, for a long time. Is it?
Well, I think it'll be 15-16 months now. So it's nice to get him a run out. You know, against, I don't know who he is, some journeyman. He's had about 18 knockouts out of 25, but he's still a journeyman. He's not a world level boxer, is he? So it'll be good for a Hughie just to get a run out. We've picked him as well because we believe he's durable. And, you know, he poses some kind of threat. So it's not to achieve anything or look $1 million. It's just a run out, nothing more.
It's good to see Tyson there, 10 rounds sparring with Tom. And you know, back in here, he's looking happy and healthy, and got that look in his eye again, Peter.
He has, you know, he's been in some bad places, Tyson, like all of us. You know, there's no airs and graces here, it's what it is. You know, and Tyson, he's probably one of the most genuine fellas out there because he wears his heart on his sleeve, nothing's behind closed doors, he speaks what he's got to speak, you know, whether somebody likes it or not. And some of that is to his detriment sometimes, and financially as well. But there's only one Tyson, isn't there? But that's just the way it is. But he's in a good place at the moment. He's back, he's mentally focused, and he's happy where he is. He's training here 3 times a week. Yeah. He's doing his running in between. And I know Mick Hennessy, he's working on that at the moment with the rest of the team, getting his suspension lifted. So that's why there's no announcements on Tyson or anything else, because he is currently still suspended, and we're hoping, excuse me, providing Hughes had do the right thing, then he can box. So we have to wait and see.
You just don't know the situation with that at the moment at all?
Don't know, can't say, can't make any judgments because it's not our call, but we are on with it, and hopefully sense will prevail.
You said last time as well, Tyson, like anybody, you know, you need some kind of something to get out of bed for, something to work hard for, and that was the problem, because he had no, you know, there was no decision of them, there's no date set or anything like that, and he's the kind of person who needs that incentive maybe to, you know, well, go through that hard work. And
he's always said, coming all the way through his career, Tyson, you know, just get me regular fights. You know, he's somebody that belongs in there. He doesn't belong hitting a bag, he doesn't belong skipping a rope in a gym. He belongs fighting, because that's all he's interested in, you know. So he's got his mind in the right place, and I think with the inactivity, with the politics and everything else. But look, he won the world title, and I don't know what happened, you know, but it's all water under a bridge. The main thing is he's back focused, and I believe on his A game, he is the best fighter in the world, and I just think he's just wiped the floor with a lot. From what I can see, and how he is, and styles make fights. I think he's in a good place.
There's a case of him just training, getting fit before he starts the serious boxing training, just, you know, shifting the weight, getting the muscles working again, and, you know, enjoying it mainly. That's the main thing for him, Tyson.
He's enjoying it, and we had a chat, and I said, you know, wouldn't it be a nice thing to get you on the bill? You know, two cousins on the bill, one fighting for a world title. I know they shared the bill before, but not like this. So he's ticking over. And once we wait and see which way the land's sliding with the suspension and that gets released off him, then he can full steam ahead in camp. Because if we're waiting and all of a sudden I put him in camp, I'm not going to get somebody from 26 stone to fight weight, am I, in that time? So I need him steady, so as when I do put the foot down, he's prepared, his body's prepared. I think he's lost a couple of stone already. So he's getting there. He'll be, if they lift the suspension on him, will he be fit for September? Yes, he will. Will he be world-class fit for September? No. But he's fit enough to deal with any decent opposition, let's put it that way. He'll look good. He'll look, he'll be in good shape. He'll be behind 20 stone anyway. And he's fought at that many a time.
Shake the ring rust off a bit and just get back in there, back under the light. What do you think about that, having a fight on, you know, on, in September? What do you think about that, a warm up one?
Well, that's why he's here, in the gym.
He's happy to do it. Yeah.
Wants to fight. He ain't going to train here if he's not going to fight on, or nothing's coming off it. He knows there's a chance. You know, we're optimistic, and like I said, if his suspension gets lifted, then so well and good. If it doesn't get lifted, then we'll have to wait for the final hearing and see the outcome of that. But it is it's hindering him, and when his mind's in the right place, you know, it should not be anything more. Hopefully they'll let him carry on.
It's ironic, isn't it, where when he was coming through and he won the world title, it's almost now that the heavyweight division has had a real insurgence, and he's, you know, it's interesting again, lots of challenges out there. Does that motivate him to get back in there now he knows that there's other people who are, you know, maybe taking his place and that kind of thing?
I've always said, you know, if you're good enough, you can come into boxing. You know, you see the elite fighters, they come out of it, they come back in it, they come back in it. If you're prepared right, and you're mentally focused, and you've done everything right in the gym, and you've carried your instructions, and you've got that self-steely confidence in your mind, and you know which way you're going with your boxing, then elite fighters can come back. You know, he'll probably have, if we bring him back in September, it won't be against a journeyman anyway. We'll stick him in. Within a top 10 fighter in the world. He'll be, we'll put him straight back in, because he's more than capable.
He's a bit different to most heavyweights, isn't he? A bit different to a lot of them who have, you know, been around and, you know, been on the scene. So
he's had the hard knocks. It's like the young heavyweights coming through now, and all the young fighters, you know, they'll push against the tide when it's going a little bit wrong. You know, it's like a bit of a macho thing. Because don't forget, any fighter that gets in these ropes, they got to fight in art. They don't want to let anybody down. It's a special kind of species that get in that ring, yeah? But it's just turning that tap on and off and being in control. So when you're a defence expert, because defence is the key in all walks of life, isn't it? It's defence first, attack later. So it's just having that confidence, the skill set, offset your opponent, where you're standing, you know, your feints, keeping them busy, and setting the shots up in your own time. Yeah? And going when you're ready. Tyson's got that, but he never got it easy, did he? Because he had life and deaths with McDermott. You remember them. You know, he went off the rails. You know, he got put over in the second round with Nevin Pajic, who brought just a journeyman from Canada. You know, because Tyson wasn't dedicated as well. He had natural talent, but he never really knuckled down to it. And I think after that, and he had a scare as well with Nikolai Further in Ireland. You know, he got caught again. So the writing was on the wall. So we just sat down and had a chat with him. And as I said, you know, get your act together, because this is as far as you're going to go. You might have 17, 18 wins, but if these type of people are getting to you, you've got a problem. So you've got the talent. So if you want to do it properly, do it properly. And if you don't, leave it alone. And he's never looked back since. But he's had, like everybody else, all these young ones coming through the gym, you know, he's had the same thoughts. Like when I go over, like with Con, with Tom, even my son Hughie, we've had all this. It's just a repeat to me, because I've had it all already. I know what happens, and a lot of it is mental. I keep saying it, but it's going at your own pace, and that relaxedness comes with experience, not overnight. You can get in there and have all the skills under the sun. You know, you can spar like a world champion, but you've got to get the experience in before this rings a bell. But it will click. It's like cogs in a wheel. Eventually the cogs land, and what was very hard for you 4 or 5 fights ago, you think to yourself, you know, you can do as much in 2 shots. You know, you can be a busy fool in there. So Tyson's learnt all of that. And the main thing, the breaking point with Tyson was, like, when you ask Tyson what he likes as fighters, Tyson will say to you, I like Rocky Marciano, I like the Raging Bull, you know, come in, tear up, rip your face off type of guys, you know. And I said to him, I said, to get him to turn that corner, I said, you can't fight like that. I said, you're too tall. Use your attributes. Boring, don't want to know. Getting his gloves, kicking him up against that wall, yeah? Coming back to the head post, headbutting it about 6 times, yeah? You know, I've even had people abroad, yeah, run out the gym thinking he's lost it completely. Yeah, they've done one. Yeah, that's Tyson. So the thing is, you've got to go through all of this, and the penny's got to drop. And when it did drop eventually, yeah, it was like a kid in a sweet shop. He went, this is so easy. Oh, and he's doing all of that, and he's slipping back. You know, that was the real Tyson. But it took years to come out. You know, when did he turn pro? 08? 08, 012. It still wasn't right for him there. I think around late 012, 13, that's when the penny really started to drop. And he started to box properly.
What fight did you first see that in, when you knew it's getting through to him?
Well, the Rogan fight, when he had the Rogan in, I think it was April 012, was it? And I just said to him, do what I tell you. And Tyson just done, carried out his instructions. So it wasn't really, although he was doing it and he's self doing it, he wasn't comfortable doing it. It was a new thing for him. So when he really got used to it, I think he took Kevin Johnson, I think 12 rounds in Ireland as well. And he really, from then in his sparring and stuff, I think after that fight, he really realised how easy he could make it. And then he just got ready and just super relaxed.
He boxed southpaw the whole fight, didn't he, against Rogan as well?
He boxed southpaw, and he hadn't boxed the southpaw before, not stayed in it anyway. He just like little bits and pieces. But you know the fighters, you get to train with them in here, you get to see the weaknesses and the strengths, and you give them the strengths. And the only reason we took Rogan on the southpaw is because Tyson was still getting hit over his orthodox jab. So in that 4 months I had him, I still couldn't correct it in time. So on the last 2 or 3 weeks before the fight, I turned him around, because I said, you'll get whacked out, because he was still doing this over his jab. He couldn't stop leaning over. So he just couldn't get that jab right. So that was the main reason we turned him around, to come away from the right hand, because you watch him in the past, he's always been decked with a straight right over the top of the jab. So that's why I turned him around there. But he's ironed all the flaws out. And one thing of note as well, you see Tyson, he has had ups and downs, and for all young heavyweights coming through, you know, you can have hassle in the gym, but he's had hassle under the bright lights, hasn't he? You know, look what they said when Cunningham put him over. Oh, 6'9", cruiserweight's done him in. He's got no chance. My phone was ringing off to get fights for him. Yeah, everybody wanted to fight him all of a sudden because of that. Yeah. You know? Yeah. So what does it tell you? You know, look what he become to achieve. So it is, it's all up here. And you know, sometimes you got to learn, it ain't going to come in 5 minutes. We're not going to wave a magic wand, are we, and say, hit the bag, do what I tell you, and it's all coming. Mm. You know, you might take 2 or 3% of what I'm saying to you, and then just building on it, repetition, building on it, and it comes. World-level boxing requires dedication, listening, thought process, and just trial and error, and it comes. If you're dedicated enough, you can do it.
He proved that in a Klitschko. He stuck to a game plan, didn't he? He didn't get involved, and he boxed the perfect fight to beat Klitschko. So it all come to a head in the most important fight of his career then.
Well, he did. You know, he had a good 11, because I said, look, we could lose this fight. You know, I've not watched the fight back at all, to be honest. I don't know whether I've had time. I've not seen it. Mm. So if you listen to the corner, I said to him, I said, look, we can have a lot of regrets here. I said, we come to stop Klitschko. So I said, we're here in the 11th round, how do you feel? I said, my opinion, go and try and take him out, because you're not going to get a decision in Germany. So he went out in the 11, hurt him in the 11th. The referee helped Klitschko and gave him a reprieve. And Tyson really forced it in the 11th. And he come back in the 11th, and I said, do the same thing in the 12th. And that's why Tyson had a bit of a hard 12th. Because he was trying to force it and get Klitschko out of there. Mm-hmm. But anywhere else in the world, I'd have said, you've won by a landslide, just stick to your boxing. But you know, it's fighting for a world title. It's a major event. You can't take chances, you know.
The Klitschko bill as well, yeah.
Yeah, on his bill, yeah.
Obviously you said that Tyson's, you know, he's happy when he's in the ring. Like we said, Adele, not only that, you've got Joshua who's come to, you know, is now heavyweight champion of the world as well, so yeah. There's a lot of interesting things out there as well. Does that motivate him as well to get that big fight with Joshua?
I think he just once he's back and he gets his head right, I think he'll come back. These fights will happen. Don't forget, Tyson's 28, isn't he? He's only 28. You know, he's 25-0. He's got vast experience, and he's been brought through the right way.
Done it the right all the way through.
Done it the right way. You know the titles he's won. He's won everything under the sun. So he belongs where he is. He's a world-class heavyweight. And that's took years to get. Because no matter what you do with him, he will get in that ring and be loose and relaxed no matter what the event. Because ultimately he knows, yeah, why do I want to listen to all that bullshit and carry on when it's only affecting me? I'm the one who's got to do it. So I don't need all these mental shit going on outside the ring. Am I going to do this? Am I going to do that? I'm just going to use my mind, totally concentrate, get through this 12 rounds and get this fight won. So he's got that mentality. So he uses, if he's got any nerves at all, uses it to his advantage.
And in your opinion, if he is in shape and his mind is 100% on it, do you believe there's no one who can touch him in heavyweight boxing?
Look, I said years ago when he was getting put down as a journeyman, when he was throwing a right hand and bringing his back foot level and getting knocked on his back, you know, and he couldn't throw a straight shot. I said then, and people was going, ridiculed us. And I remember the time when he put when he had to vacate the British title, and everybody was going on about David Price. You know, the amount of stick we got was unbelievable. He shit himself, he's no good, he's a coward, journeyman's putting him over. But listen, you know your fighter. Yeah, it ain't about me listening to public opinion. Yeah, we're in this gym doing it. I don't listen to nobody, to be honest, not regards public opinion, because we go when you go when you're ready. titles are always going to be there. If you're good enough, you can go and get a title anyway. If you want more money and you're not happy with the money you're getting, well, shape up then and be a better fighter. There's money there, there's as much money as you want to spend if you're good enough. See? So you have to wait and you've got to step and get there first. It's up to me to say, are you ready or not? I don't like going taking my fighters into world fights because these fighters, we've got a bond here. Do you know what I mean? I care about them as much as I ought to do anybody in this gym. Because that's the way you are. If you want the best out of your fighter, you've got to gel with them properly. So just be open and genuine. You want the best for the fighter. And that's the way it is here. So I'm not going to put anybody in for a pay packet. Not going to happen. I turned down £1 million for Tyson on a few occasions. Yeah? Because he was getting in the gym. And just because he wasn't doing things how I wanted him, so what? He's living, he's breathing, he's got money. We're all not destitute for money, are we? I've got businesses, I don't need boxing to get me living. I don't do boxing to get me living anyway. So why am I going to suddenly think about a pay packet? You know, Hughie's got niggles in his back. We've turned down £940,000 sterling. Do I look like I'm turning up for a pay packet? I'm coming to win. My fighter is coming to win. I ain't coming to lose. I ain't gonna do an excuse after it and say, well, he couldn't move because he had cringes in his back. What kind of a useless cunt am I? Sorry for the French. But it's not gonna happen. I am not putting my fighters in unless they're ready. So any kind of problems they've got to be A1.
You know, the mental side of it as well. You've got a couple of young heavyweights coming through, and you was over at the forum last weekend. You've got Tom Aspinall and Con Sheehan.
Yeah.
Con was a bit upset after his fight, and he felt he didn't perform very well. And you know, it's all learning curve for him. And like you said, you have been there with Tyson and Hughie, and
100%
the same kind of things.
Yeah, it's all right. We're all right. Fast forward in 6 or 7 years, and looking at Tyson and Co. Yeah, and you know, but they've all been through it. It's what it is. You know, Masarak, he lost every round. He was going to lose every round. I'm putting him in fights where he can't get beat. I'm putting him in fights to learn from. So these type of fights he's going to get. Whether he clicks it on that night and things go wrong, he felt flat. You know, so when you're flat, you know, you've got to... I just said a minute ago in here, I said Andre Ward made a fabulous comment. I box uncomfortable and enjoy it uncomfortable. That's one of the best sayings I've heard from him. And that saying has come from who? One of the best pound-for-pound fighters in the world. Why is he the best pound-for-pound fighter in the world? Because he thinks like that, yeah? People might say when you come in the gym and you hear me speak, I'm a parrot. I'm not a parrot. I know what I'm talking about in boxing. I know me boxing inside out. And it's getting everything through. And you have to think like this. You have to fight like that. Fight uncomfortable. Not, I'm into 3 or 4 rounds, yeah? You've heard of championship rounds in boxing. Yeah, fight uncomfortable. Don't think to yourself, I'm going to be tired in a minute, hope I don't go tired, hope I don't go this. When you get that in your mind, you're tired already. It's already happening.
You wish it on yourself.
And you're putting it on yourself, and then pressure's coming again. Don't give a shit about that. I said earlier on, you know, Tyson comes back to the corner, my legs feel like lead. Yeah? I said, shake them off and go for a walk then. Don't worry about it. Okay. Now the difference is with Tyson as well, he totally believes in what I tell him as well. Because we've got that communication, me and him. He hangs on every word I say in that corner, ultimately. He looks for advice, he gets the advice, and he does it. So when he's feeling a little bit tired and I say, shake your legs off, and I like that, back off. Yeah? Back off, use your boxing, slip and slide, and just get used because you've been going at a fast pace. Eases off, couple of rounds later, how do you feel? Do you know what? I'm going to steam into him, knock him out in a second. So there's a complete reverse role of how he was a couple of rounds earlier. So it's just having that mindset. You've got to pace yourself, pace your round. Boxing spurts. And when you're tired, learn how to defend yourself. And you can still do damage tired. It's all about keeping your composure. Everybody's going to be tired. I don't know any sprinters that can sprint 1,000 meters, do you? It's common sense, isn't it?
Well, Pete, I love your passion for the game, and always brilliant to see you and catch up with you.
It's always good to see you, Chris. We've had some good interviews over the years,
haven't we? We have, and long may it continue.
Had some crackers, yeah.
We have. I like
Zelfa Barrett.
Yeah.
I think he's a world-class fighter. Yeah. I've seen him slowly improve all the time. And I'm very pleased for Pat as well. You know, and Tommy as well. Yeah. You know, you've all done a fabulous job there. I know you worked with Pat. And that Moston gym. You know, for that, Brian Hughes. I met Brian Hughes in 1986. And sparred a cruiserweight. He had John Joe Green back then. And many, many years ago. And he was a very, very nice man. You know, what he didn't know about boxing was nobody's business. And for him to now have this illness he's got, but he's done fabulous because he brought Pat up on the lads from nothing. And look what they achieved. And now they're passing it on, and Jim's thriving. You know, but from what I've, I know they've got other talent in the gym. Is it Lyndon or somebody? He's very good as well.
Good, yeah.
But from what I'm looking of him, he could be a world champion in the next 18 months. Definitely.
Loads of talent. Yeah, I think they'll appreciate that. We'll do it again soon. Yeah, see you tomorrow. Yeah. No, definitely, Pete. Yeah, always a pleasure, sir.
No problem.